Catalyst is a social enterprise, and we do a lot of work with victims and perpetrators and their families, not just when a crime has been committed, but also to help with rehabilitation and restoring things. We do lots of restorative justice work. I think the benefits are huge. At the moment, we have a criminal justice system, not a victim justice system, but even the criminals don't seem to be getting justice. We've got recidivism at really high levels, particularly for young people. It's touching on 80%, and it's very expensive. So the cynic in me thinks that maybe this whole new wave of restorative practice that's been pushed through government is simply to save money. But so be it. You know, if it does save money, it also delivers better results for everybody who's been harmed during a crime or any incident where any harm has been caused. I think a lot of people have a misunderstanding about restorative practice, thinking that it's instead of the punishment. It doesn't need to be. It can run parallel. You know, I've done some restorative work in some prisons, so people are being punished at the same time. But what the restorative work tends to do for the perpetrator is it allows them to take full responsibility for their actions. They get to hear the real implications of what they've done and the consequences of what they've done from the people that it hurt. They get to hear the reality, which quite often they've never considered.
Have you ever been to a kid's party? You walk into the room, there's one of those bubble machines going, and there's bubbles everywhere. Have you seen that?
Mm-hmm.
When you step into that room, the first thing you notice is all the bubbles. After you've been in the room for a minute or two, the bubbles just float by. You pay no mind to them. You don't think about them, you don't worry about them, you really don't notice them anymore. And I think that's what thoughts are like. So you can imagine all these bubbles flying through, the 150,000 million a day, most of them you don't notice, and then there's one really dangerous one comes along and you go, oh. And then you think about the thought. So it's not the thought itself. The thought had no power. If you'd let it go, like all those other thoughts, it wouldn't have had any power over you. It's your thinking about the thought that causes it to have some sort of power over you.
Anything that's creative allows people a little bit of distance to what they've done. So it gives them, you know, they can talk about the crime, they can talk about a crime, a situation that perhaps if they were trying to do it, you know, intellectually or less creatively, they wouldn't have that distance. They'd still be talking about themselves. If a picture tells 1,000 words, you know, I don't know how many a film tells, but films are powerful. It's a very powerful medium. And it's good experience. It gets them to re-examine what they've done visually, but they have to also plan it, they have to think it through. I think it's a great project, yeah.